the moment, there's certainly an increasing interest in electronic music, music that is produced by electronic oscillators.
Think of a sound, now make it. Any sound is now possible. Any combination of sounds is now possible.
I think people who judge it harshly have to remember that it is in a pioneer stage as a viable art form.
Electronic music proper is not about making instrumental type noises.
One thing which is odd is that there's a missing chapter, which is EMS in all the books about electronic music. People do not know what incredible mechanical adventures we were up to.
With electronic music, I was always much freer at the beginning. I was more inhibited with my instrumental music because I actually took it as a course, you see. I went to a counterpoint teacher. I was, to some extent, inhibited by what I was taught. Electronic music, we were all at the coalface in the 50s, so anything went, so to speak. I started to seriously design a studio. This coincided with the post-war appearance of an enormous amount of junk from the Army, Navy, and Air Force. So for someone who knew what to do and could handle a soldering iron and could design audio equipment, even if you only had 30 shillings in your pocket, you could get something. And so I was able to get started on my electronic experiments.
At this point in London's history, high modernity, London is being rebuilt after the Second World War. And I think you can think of people like Tristram Keary as dreaming of a future soundscape of London.
Electronic music in the 50s was considered avant-garde, and we were operating on the fringes of what people generally thought of as music.
Tristram, I'd like to begin by challenging you, first of all, to give me your simple definition of music.
If you want a very quick and not very complete definition, music is sound which has been organized. At any period, a composer tends to use his resources. Nowadays, we have all the resources of recording and artificially produced sound of various kinds, and the composers are using it.
With the invention of tape, for the first time, a high-quality linear recording medium could be easily edited. This was a revolution in recording.
Music concrete is music built out of found sound. So you'll be applying musical techniques and musical theory to non-musical sound.
So music concrete was what the Parisians called music which is cut from real sounds, recorded by a microphone. Electronic music, on the other hand, uses oscillators and no microphones. It uses generators to generate things. Personally, I find these distinctions a bit academic. I don't care. I'll mix and match. I'll use some electronics and some real sounds.
Tristram developed the techniques. Well, I mean, he was way ahead of his time. And he was experimenting with these techniques from the early 50s.
But as private studios went, I think mine was probably one of the best in Britain. The BBC were fairly slow off the mark, you see. They didn't start their radiophonic workshop until probably 1957 or so. I mean, composers often came to me who couldn't handle electronics at all. and they would lean on me to come and get me to do sounds for them in my studio. But very often, I would come to a point of working on something where I wanted a certain sort of filter or a certain sort of gadget, which I hadn't got. So I would stop being a composer for the time being and become an engineer for a couple of days, design this new thing, build it. It probably wouldn't work the first time, test it, get it right, and put it together, and then get on with the piece. Electronic music seemed to have no limits. You get right away from saying, this is in the key of E flat, you know. You can use any pitch you like. You don't talk about C, you talk about a frequency. We all dreamt about in the early days that it was a music sans frontière. It had no boundaries. Instrumental music has, unfortunately, boundaries by the pitch of the instrument, you know. The piano will only go so far up and down, and no instrument will exceed its range in that way. In electronic music, you can theoretically go from the highest notes you can hear to the lowest notes you can hear, the entire audio range. People didn't take it seriously at first. I couldn't get any royalties on it, for example, from the Performing Rights Society, because they said it's not music.
I think a lot of his early electronic music with Doctor Who, he did the very first Dalek story in 1963.
It was totally uncompromising.
They are approaching.
And so you had audience who maybe wouldn't listen to this kind of electronic music or would dismiss it as, you know, rubbish and plinky plonky or whatever. They were quite happy to be terrified by it for half an hour every Saturday night. So the influence it had was a subversive one. It was introducing this kind of music and sound to audiences by stealth.
Electronic music was seen in Britain in this period, you know, the late 60s, as a totally weird thing. People would be exposed to it through shows like Doctor Who, but I think to make the transition to this being a form of entertainment that's kind of enjoyable, that was a huge leap.
You haven't lived if you haven't got a tape recorder.
But in the 60s, we were sort of at a peak of our belief in science and technology. Trips to the moon, trips to Mars, nuclear power stations.
In terms of the scientific revolution.
So there's a famous speech by the British Prime Minister, Harold Wilson.
The Britain that is going to be forged in the white heat of this revolution will be no place for restrictive practices or for outdated methods on either side of industry.
That Britain was going to move ahead with science and technology. If you think of electronic music in that context, it kind of fits in. You know, here was the science and technology of music being pushed to the next level.
I don't know quite how I came into electronic music itself. I like doing experimental music by recording sounds. And it was very early on that I realized that cutting tape was a hopeless procedure, and that really this had to be done in a more sensible way. And this was the beginning of a digital age.
Because the way that electronic music was made back then was with essentially quarter-inch tape, and that's a very time-consuming process. So I think a lot of people, including Peter, were thinking, if only we could have an electronic way of doing this, where we could make one sound after another, and that device that makes one sound after another is called a sequencer.
So my first searches were to get somebody who could design a sequencer, but nobody seemed to be able to do it until somebody said that I should go and see David Cockrell.
A friend of mine gave me a crystal set, and that started me on electronics, putting aerials out of the window, risking death by lightning.
Peter had some technical ability, but David Cockrell, as Peter would describe him, was his kind of electronic genius.